Now, for more on this, I spoke to Paul Reig. He's an associate at the WRI and a co-author of the group's report on shale gas and water availability.
We found overall, I think, three things that are worth highlighting. The first one is that a lot of the areas where shale resources are located are already facing high levels of competition for water, or there is no water at all. You know, as I mentioned before, 38% of the area is in areas of high water stress or arid conditions. The other interesting finding is that the demand for water and the amount of water that's available where the shale is located is very variable. There's a high level of variability within a country, within a shale formation around the world. And what this does is it really increases the risk of accessing water, right? Because you don't know what the situation is going to be, and you don't know what the demand for water is going to be at that given location. And then the third interesting finding is that over top of a lot of these shale formations, there's high population density, indicating that there's already a lot of competition for water, you know, and areas of high population density are also going to see more concerns around hydraulic fracturing that could lead to social opposition, for example.
Is there anything specific in China in the report that they're doing right or wrong?
One of the things that we do in the report is we provide results at the global level, but we also take a really close look at 11 countries, including China, including the U.S. and another one. 60% of the area where shale resources are located are in areas of high water stress or arid conditions. That's almost double than what we saw in the U.S., indicating that the challenges in accessing fresh water in China might be greater than what industry has faced in the U.S.
Any particular reason you think why that might be the case?
Well, you know, part of the west of the country is very arid. It's naturally limiting in fresh water, and part of the east of the country is really high levels of competition for water already.
So hold the ground, pump water in, oil comes up in theory, or natural gas, and it's controversial because of the amount of water that's required to push into the ground.
And because of the chemicals that go in with it, there is uncertainty around the effect that these chemicals could have on aquifers and other natural systems.
So your report talks a little bit about the requirement of sift fresh water, mm-hmm. that because of the high use of fresh water, it takes away the fresh water for uses for other things, such as, for example, you and I taking a shower, or farms that might be nearby that need the water for the agriculture. Mm-hmm. How serious is this problem, in your opinion?
So I think one of the big concerns from stakeholders in river basins where hydraulic fracturing has taken place is that the demand for water for increased hydraulic fracturing would compete with other local uses. I think the issue is serious at a local level in some areas around the world, and that's what this report finds, is that many areas where shale resources are located are also areas where already we see really high levels of competition for water or very arid.
Can I ask a dumb question?
Sure.
Why does it have to be fresh water?
The reason why fresh water is probably the priority choice when sourcing water for hydraulic fracturing is because it is the easiest to use as a medium to mix in other chemicals. It's basically like starting with a white sheet, right? It's a lot easier to add salts and to add, you know, sand and other particles that is used in hydraulic fracturing versus taking brackish water or salt water, which already has a lot of particulates into it.
So, okay, let's say that I own an area that I want to do hydraulic fracturing. Mm-hmm. I want to put a hole in the ground, I want to pump water in, and you want me to do, or this report is recommending to do a risk assessment. So I do the risk assessment, and let's say the outcome is, yes, there is a risk that communities around the area may not have as much water as before. So that seems to be a foregone conclusion. That's likely the outcome. What's one to do? What's the solution here?
So that could be one of the outcomes. You know, you could also, you know, come up with a finding that there is plenty of water. But in the case if there wasn't, you know, I would recommend, I think the report does it as well, is that industry look into alternatives to using fresh water. There is technology out there, and industry is provided solutions to use brackish water, for example, or to recycle produced water from other operations nearby, or to even tap into other sources of water, such as, you know, recycled wastewater municipalities.
What are the recommendations?
Yeah, so WRI puts forward four recommendations for governments and countries that are interested in exploring and potentially developing shale resources. The first one is to conduct water risk assessments, you know, to understand the risks and issues around accessing water at a very local level, right, taking into consideration all factors and all demands for water. The second one is to increase transparency on the private sector side by disclosing more how they plan to meet their demand for water and how they plan to manage it, and from the government side around how much water is available and what the existing demand is from other users. The third one is to increase or ensure adequate water governance. I think a lot of the concerns from stakeholders around these issues is the lack of confidence in the fact that water is being managed and that there's enough water to meet their needs moving forward in the future. And last, the fourth one is, you know, whenever possible, to minimize the demand for fresh water using technology or alternative sources such as brackish water or recycled water.
That was Paul Reig, co-author of the World Resources Institute Global Shale Gas Development Report.